Thank you very much. It's so wonderful to see all of you. So nice. As Brian said, the 48th Research Center that have now been going on for 7 years is about to finalize. And then, of course, after 7 years of hard work, it's time to ask ourselves, what have we learned? What have we achieved in this research center? And of course, you could line up numbers as how many presentations and how many publications, as I did here on the slides, we have been writing, and also not at least the 12 PhD that is an outcome of the research. But it's also interesting to ask, what have you learned in terms of all these different research contributions? If we sum them up, are there something that we can really say this is the outcome of all this work? That's what I will try to present here. And in the research center, we asked ourselves that question in the beginning of the year and started to wrapping up all of this, and it ended up in the research paper that is also part of your book of abstracts. And there's also a small booklet telling about the project. And it's based on that's what I will present here. But before I come to the overall results, when we try to sum everything up, I'll go back and start a little bit at the beginning. Because what was the purpose of the 48th Research Center? Well, you can say it has been to, if we just put it into one line, it's been to investigate the future of district heating and cooling. And from the very beginning, we have based it on a one-liner saying that district heating is here to stay, but district heating has to change. That's have been our belief when we have done all this research. So you can say what we have been doing is sort of qualifying more what is actually the role of district heating in the future energy system. And also how should the technology then develop itself in order to fulfill such role. And of course, there's sort of two issues to this, because it's difficult to say what is the role of technology in the future if you have no idea of that future. So you sort of need to generate an idea of how that future would look like in order to answer such a question. And that's also why the name of this conference have always been Smart Energy Systems and Fourth Generation District Heating. Because it's the dialogue between the technology and the future that we wish to generate. And I'll say a little bit first about the future energy system and the role of district heating then. And going back to the beginning of the discussion we had in the beginning of the project, we started to discuss a little bit about the definitions, how to define this, both how to define the future energy system and also define the role of district heating, the fourth generation district heating. And we started with looking at the smart grid that entered the whole debate in around 2005, just as a concept without no definition really in the beginning. Then we looked on the definitions that came on later, and they are a little different, but they all agree that smart grid was all about electricity. Smart grids. But we could also see papers like this one from the European Commission, not only talking about electricity smart grid, but also starting talking about smart heating and cooling grids. So we put all this together and tried then to define more what the different aspects of this was. So we defined smart electricity grids based on the definition. There was all of a synergy of that, you can say. but then added a definition of smart thermal grids like district heating and cooling, and also we added a definition of smart gas grids. But the whole idea of defining this was then on top of it we could define what we then call a smart energy system. And the whole idea of the smart energy system is that we have the different smart grids, but they should also collaborate. And it's when they collaborate, we'll be able to find the best solutions. So district heating is a smart thermal grid, but it also has to be seen with other smart grids, and they have to be collaborating into one system. And that's why we promoted the smart energy system. And you can say, as we have talked about this for now some years, it's sort of developed into what I will claim is not only a concept, it's actually also an approach, or you can even say a theory. It's a theory claiming that if we want to identify the most affordable and best solutions to go to a 100% renewable energy system or a sustainable energy system in the far future, including the entire system, then we need to take a look, an integrated approach. We need to take all the sectors into consideration, and we need to have a focus on how they can assist one another and collaborate. Otherwise, if we do not have this approach, then we will not be able to identify the best and most affordable solutions, and also the, I will claim, the most politically liable solution to be implemented. There's a number of reasons for that. I'll not go in detail, but just mention that one of the reasons is that there is a huge difference between the cost of storage. It's so much more expensive to store electricity than it is to store heat and liquid fuel and gas. There's also an issue regarding if we store, if we try to store heat in individual houses compared to if we do it together in district heating. Again, it's so much more affordable to do it together. So it's so much more likely that we can really store over a long period if we have a district heating grid compared to if we try to do it in each house and each flat. There's also the issue that the storage we already have now is the cheap ones, namely the liquid fuel storage and the gas storage and some thermal storage. And basically, apart from some hydropower, then we do not really have any electricity storage in the system, and not at all in the Danish system. Also, if we take a look at the distribution grid, how we distribute energy to the houses, here it's the Danish context, but the interesting thing is that in a peak hour where we distribute the most electricity to the houses, then we actually only distribute around half of what we distribute in the gas net and in the district heating grid. So, and I mention this because if we take a look of what we have, then we can do it so much more affordable if we make this work together regarding if we want to disregard some of the grids and try to only do it by one grid, because it really means a lot of expansion of such grid. So for these reasons, that's the approach we have taken. And we have used then, of course, models so we could analyze not only one sector, but all of the sectors also on an hourly basis, a whole smart energy smart systems. And we applied those models to generate scenarios, in this case here for Denmark, together with the Danish organizations of Association of Engineers, a smart energy vision for Denmark. We also done the same thing for the whole of Europe, simply trying to analyze how could the whole of Europe be 100% renewable energy, what kind of sectors, and how should we do it in an appropriate way. And in all these scenarios, district heating plays an important role, and also district cooling is included. And just to take a small look at the storage, if we take the smart energy approach to this, then we can actually do, by taking the storage we already have and then expanding it. On this diagram, it looks like a little bit expanding the thermal storage, but actually it's quite an expansion compared to what we have now. But by doing this, then we can actually make all the sectors work together, and also then store the wind and the PV in an affordable way. So that's sort of the vision of the system and how district heating plays an important role in that. And then based on that, we also defined the concept of the fourth generation district heating. And we defined it as, now I'll not read all the words here, but more show the diagram. We defined it as a thing where you have to take, of course, a look at the houses. How can we heat the houses with lower temperature when they are better insulated? And of course, the grid, how can we distribute the district heating? But it's also to do with how, what kind of heat sources will we have, especially in the future when there will be no more coal-fired power stations that as we have now, they'll be replaced by wind and so on, so the CHP will be much less. But also how to integrate it with the rest of the system, and then of course also how to plan for it and how to make the economical and legal frameworks to implement it and to operate it. And this also reflects in how we designed the 48th Research Center with the different work packets that we have here. At the same time, we also issued this diagram here that was first made by Danfoss, and then we elaborated on it in the 48th project here, and where we sort of illustrate the fourth generation, also illustrating both how the temperature is decreasing throughout the different generations, but also how we look into a future with a lot of different types of sources. And of course, the idea that in order to use those sources in an efficient and good way, then we have to lower the temperatures. We published that in a definition paper in 2014, you can say, in the relative beginning of the project after a couple of years. And this paper have actually had quite an impact. In the new paper I'm talking about, that is in the Book of Abstract, we have sort of made a review of all scientific papers mentioning this concept of fourth generation district heating. As you can see here, this is really gaining a momentum in scientific literature and is actually expanding a lot. And 2018, this year, is not even included here on the diagram. You can also see from the colors that the different aspects of this is also all of them covered in the literature. So we think we have had an impact, and also the definition papers have been cited almost now 400 times, which is pretty good on those very few years. And then of course we have also had generated the conference here, that I believe we can claim that this is the biggest international district heating conference in the world, as we have now generated, and we would like to, of course, continue this, as Brian already mentioned. Then, of course, we also had an influence among our partners. This is both in Ringkøbing Skjern, it's in Viborg, also those of you who participated in the guided tour yesterday could see also in Aalborg municipality. So this concept is being used within, of course, the project, and that's maybe not such a big surprise, but it's also interesting to see how we now get an outreach. It's been interesting for me, for example, I was invited to Stockholm to Fortum once, and they simply used the concept of fourth generation to tip off how they had their system in the district heating system of Stockholm. I was also invited to the Janssen manufacturing in the northern parts of Belgium, and they used the fourth generation word and also the concept when they redesigned the district heating for their industrial facility. In Slovakia, they also used this to debate how the district heating has a future and what kind of future. And then when we prepared this conference, I was contacted by our Japanese colleagues who are also present here today, and they are just told me they are starting a 48 forum in Japan, and there are many other things like this. And also this whole conference is people collaborating on this concept. We also had, I think, via the heat map Europe studies, quite an influence on the European agenda. And it's been very good for us to see how when the Commission visioned, came with this district heating paper, the heating strategy of Europe, then district heating was already mentioned on the first page, and this was really something new compared to what had been there before. But also interesting to see in the same heating and cooling strategy how it's emphasized not only that district heating can do a lot of good to energy efficiency by recycling the heat, but also how district heating has an important role to play in integrating the electricity into the system. There's quite a few sentences and focus on that as well. Some of you may recall a couple of years ago we issued also this video that is on YouTube that is also within targeting the European audience on how the smart heating can look like based on our research here. Now back to the paper where we try to ask ourselves now if we put all this together, is there sort of an outcome that we can say in few words that is the outcome of this project? There's of course a lot of different research results, but can we sum it up? So we asked ourselves, could we sort of quantify the costs and the benefits of having a fourth generation system, district heating system, when we enter this future sustainable system? And then we defined, well, we could compare implementing a fourth generation compared to staying on a third generation. So what will the benefits and what will the cost of doing that be? Of course, the cost when on wall, we have to do something in the houses so they can be heated with lower temperatures and something with the operation of the distribution grid. But then the benefits, of course, will be lower heat losses, but it will also be that we can utilize more excess heat, we can utilize with higher efficiency the heat pumps and the CHP plants and the other things and the solar thermal that will be in the system. So that's sort of the task we gave ourselves. So what we did is to define a future energy system. We did that based on the smart energy systems vision for Denmark. So defining this is how the future 2050 could look in a 100% renewable energy and a sustainable energy systems for all sectors. And of course, district heating being a part of this together with a lot of other things. Then, based on the research we have been carrying out in work packets one, we try to quantify what will be the cost in the houses in order to make them be supplied by a fourth generation temperature level compared to a third generation. And we did the same for the operation of the distribution grid and quantify the costs of doing that. Then based on the research we carried out in work package two, we then calculated the whole system in 2050 with fourth generation and compared it to the whole system with third generation. Of course, having a focus on what influence that will have on how we can utilize the resources, both in hourly durations and also of course, in terms of better efficiencies on the heat pumps and so on and so forth. Then, of course, also in the paper we have described the work packets tree. It's not quantified, it's more describing what will then be the main focus. And there's a lot of things there, but I will just highlight at least one thing. And one thing that we should always repeat is when we go into the future and we do renovate our houses, at least that will be a very good idea to do in most countries. And to do that, we should, of course, renovate them with the purpose of decreasing the heat demand. But we should also do it in a way so that you can heat your house with lower temperature. So do it with that twofold purpose, is and also, of course, then tariff to operate it in a way so we can decrease the return temperature as well. And then what we do in the paper is to put this together, estimate the cost in the building, estimate the cost of operating the distribution, the district heating grids, and then, of course, estimating the benefits of the savings that we will have in the system. And the result that we come up with here is that the benefits exceeds the cost with a pretty safe margin. And the main reason for this, and this is also some of the outcome of quantifying this, is the really benefits are to be found in the system. The real benefits are to be found in the fact that we can utilize surplus heat and excess heat better. We can utilize heat pumps better. That's a lot of things, solar, thermal, and so on, we can do better. And that's where the real benefits are of the fourth generation system. Then, of course, there are additional benefits in lower heat losses and so on in it. And also the conclusion that the benefits exceeds the cost by a safe margin. Just to say a little bit, I visited Aalborg Portland cement fabric that we have here in Aalborg. They right now they supply 20% of the district heating in Aalborg on an annual basis. And they, of course, they had to supply at a certain temperature, but they told us if they were allowed to supply just at a lower temperature, 65 degrees, then they could actually supply 30% more on the installations they already have, simply because a lower temperature could mean so much. And then they have a lot of other things that they can supply even much more than that, but then they have to do investments and so on. But this just to say, one of the really important benefits of utilizing surplus heat. So that's what I had in mind to present here as the main output of the 48's research center. Then, of course, there's a lot of other things, but we'll hear more about that later on this in this conference, and already heard about it in the previous conferences as well. And just one final remark, since we are now closing the 48's project at SES. Brian already told how we will carry on in other projects, and of course we also carry on with a focus on the fourth generation district heating together with a lot of you and collaboration and so on. But I just, anyway, as this is soon closing, I would like to thank all the partners in it's been really wonderful to chair this project here. I think we had a wonderful collaboration, both internationally, but certainly also with all the industrial partners we have had in the project. So I'd like to thank all of you, and I'll certainly also like to add, I'll thank all the rest of you coming to the conferences here and discussing all this. And I hope we can carry on, and I'm sure we will carry on doing more development into this concept. I think it's very important for the future. Thank you very much.